an opportunity to spend some time in reflection and quiet, and allow ourselves to be carried by the liturgy and the music, and explore the theme a little of God's temple.
Foundation, because they were in dread of the neighboring peoples, And they offered burnt offerings upon it to the Lord, morning and evening. And they kept the festival of booths, as prescribed, and offered the daily burnt offerings by number, according to the ordinance, as required for each day, and after that the regular burnt offerings, the offerings at the new moon, and at all the sacred festivals of the Lord, and the offerings of everyone who made a free will offering to the Lord. From the first day of the seventh month, they began to offer burnt offerings to the Lord. But the foundation of the temple of the Lord was not yet laid. So they gave money to the masons and the carpenters, and food, drink, and oil to the Sidonians and the Tyrians to bring cedar trees from Lebanon to the sea, to Joppa, according to the grant that they had from King Cyrus of Persia. In the second year after their arrival at the house of God at Jerusalem, in the second month, Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, and Jeshua, son of Jozadak, made a beginning, together with the rest of their people, the priests and the Levites, and all who had come to Jerusalem from the captivity. They appointed the Levites from 20 years old and upwards to have the oversight of the work on the house of the Lord. And Jeshua with his sons and his kin, and Kadmiel and his sons, Binui and Hodavai, along with the sons of Henadad, the Levites, their sons and kin, together took charge of the workers in the house of God. When the builders laid the foundations of the temple of the Lord, the priests in their vestments were stationed to praise the Lord with trumpets, and the Levites, the son of Asaph, with cymbals, according to the directions of King David of Israel. And they sang responsively, praising and giving thanks to the Lord. For he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever towards Israel. And all the people responded with a great shout when they praised the Lord, because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. But many of the priests and Levites and head of families, old people who had seen the first house on its foundations, wept with a loud voice when they saw this house, though many shouted aloud for joy, so that the people could not distinguish the sound of the joyful shout from the sound of people's weeping, for the people shouted so loudly that the sound was heard far away. Here ends the lesson.
Thank you. So then, remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcision by those who are called the circumcision, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you were at that time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances, so that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundations of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you are also built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. Here ends the second reading.
We stand as we affirm together our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I am leaping ahead, the number of his first.
Thank you.
understood that the choir was particularly small at the time, comprising just four trebles and a bass, the bass being the Dean's butler. With words from the first epistle of Peter, the subjects covered in the libretto include the resurrection, the hope of eternal life, the instruction to love one another, and the promise that God's word endures forever.
Thank you.
spirit and in union with Christ. Let us pray to the Father. O God, the creator and preserver of all, we pray for people in every kind of need. Make your ways known on earth, your saving health among all nations. And we pray for that day when your kingdom shall come upon the whole earth. We pray for the good estate of the Catholic Church. Guide and governed by your good spirit, that all who profess and call themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life. And we pray especially that the witness of this church and of the churches in this area and the churches much further afield would be one of unity, of collaboration, of friendship, and of the witness of barriers. We commend to your Father, goodness, all those who are anyways afflicted or distressed, in body, mind, or estate. Comfort and relieve them in their need, give them patience in their sufferings, and bring good out of all their afflictions. And in a moment of quiet, we remember before God all those known to us in especial need at this time. We remember those who have gone before us in the peace of Christ, and we give you praise for all your faithful ones, with whom we rejoice in the communion of saints. All this we ask for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. And we join together in the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Our next hymn picks up the theme of Christ as our cornerstone, which we found in the lesson from Now speak in the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated.
A particular centre, the temple, the historic temple,
to the idea of a much wider, all-embracing fellowship, if you like, of those who are God's people. And there are no barriers of race or nationality or geography between them. And we're not talking in that dispensation about a temple of stones and mortar and very particular and special ceremonies, but a people across the world who St. Paul compares to the temple. So we move from the physical temple to the living temple. How does that relate to us? Well, I think we live in a time where we need to work out, perhaps in a new way, what it means to be the church in the world. And it seems fairly clear that our vision of what the church in the world should be is one that is as widely should be, as widely embracing as it can be. We are the advocates of a universal faith. We want to see, and it's not just, as I was saying this morning, the kind of inward spirituality we're looking for. We're looking for a world that looks a bit more like the world that Jesus spoke about on the Sermon on the Mount. That's what we're looking for, the kingdom of God. So it's got real life consequences. You could argue that we have had this state of affairs in the past. We have had this world, in which the Christian faith has an enormous influence right across at least what we regarded anyway as the known world. Those are a bit further away and weren't in what we thought was the known world. Presumably we're in the world that was known to them, but you know what I mean. Huge parts of the globe were Christianized. And that's what we call Christendom. It happened relatively early on, really. Happened in the 4th century. And what we see when we look at something like the coronation today is the last bit of it. It's possible, of course, that there will be some sudden turnaround, but unlikely. Except at these moments, we're not that interested as a population in what goes on in church. So how are we to commend this? This is the challenge, actually, that the church has got now. This is the historic challenge we face. How do we commend the faith that we have in Christ and the vision of a world made different in the image of Christ, of what the world can be? How do we commend that to the world without the kind of backing of the state, a whole kind of social, political, and cultural structure which we enjoyed really for about 1,000 years, maybe 1,500, 1,600, 1,700 years maybe. Maybe it didn't end until about 1950. It's in a sense, there's no easy moment you could identify. But we do seem to be in a different moment, so how do we commend it? That's the challenge that faces the church in our time. And I don't think there's any other way than commending it by who we are, what we do, and the intrinsic power that the Spirit of Christ working amongst us and then working amongst others has. The future is not going to be, the leader says we're all going to be Christians and therefore we're all going to be Christians, which was somewhat the pattern of the past. We're looking at something that's going to be much more sophisticated, much more voluntary. And actually, I think that's better, really. I think I prefer that, to be honest. But it doesn't often place difficult elements on all of us. Because if people want to know why they should be interested in the Christian faith, it's us that they're looking at. And we are its walking adverts. Don't be too intimidated by that, because we do everything relying on the presence of Christ and the work of His Spirit, because we know that we are not ourselves the perfect adverts. And actually, a little passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and your